Good evening, and welcome to the Forum on Law, Culture, and Society's wildly successful program, Trials and Errors. This is actually the first Trials and Errors that is a civil case, and it is a mass tort litigation. We've done the O.J. trial and the Casey Anthony trial and the Bernie Goetz trial, and so this is very different for us. We have a Super Bowl this weekend. Everybody, of course, knows this. There's a feature film focused on the very subject matter of today's discussion. And it's also Groundhog's Day, which the only thing I can think about is that just means that tomorrow we will wake up and the NFL will still deny that there's a relationship between concussions and brain injuries. The NFL is not here today. They were invited to participate, both the NFL itself and their lawyers. They didn't want anywhere near this stage. But we do have everyone else that really knows about this case, has been living this case, and we're gonna have a full discussion, and in fact, even the NFL's absence will be part of the discussion. Let me just quickly, briefly take you through our esteemed group of people. My colleague and longtime friend, Arthur Miller, a legendary law professor at NYU, and prior to that at Harvard, who is also the executive director of the Tisch Sports Institute. Arthur, thank you for joining us. And Chris Seeger is the man who's the plaintiff's lead counsel, represented all 5,000, in theory, all 5,000 of the players that were engaged in this mass tort litigation. Chris Seeger, lead plaintiff. one of the reasons why you've been here today, Mark Fainaru-Wada and his brother are the authors of this incredible book, New York Times bestselling book, League of Denial. If you have not read this, you ought to. It's really, oddly, a very painful page-turner because it'll hurt your head to think about what had happened to these players. It started out with Mark and his brother working as ESPN investigative reporters. While that was happening, they were working on this book. While that was happening, they were working on that film, which we just saw a clip from. And it really changed the public's mindset and the culture of understanding this trauma in national sports culture. And so, Mark, we're going to be talking to you and about your book. So, Mark Fainaru-Wada. And last but not least, sitting next to me here is New York Giant legend and Hall of Famer, NFL Hall of Famer, and one of the nicest guys who was known for really brutish hits. It's one of the paradoxes of sports. Everything about him is refined. His voice, his elegance, his dignity. And Harry Carson, you wouldn't want to be on the other side on a football field. Harry Carson, everybody. Now, Harry, let me start off by saying, on our stage, we've had President Clinton, we've had two Supreme Court justices, we've had Oscar winners, Tony winners, Pulitzer Prize winners, National Book Award winners, Nobel Peace Prize winners. We've never had a Hall of Famer before.
No.
And I will tell you, this is real. To me, this is the forum has finally arrived.
Really?
Just want you to know, this is how important this is to me.
This is why you're sitting with me.
Well,
thank you.
Mark, let me start off with you. Given all of your investigative reporting, and you know the players, and all the players involved in this, are you surprised that the NFL's not here?
No, I would be surprised if they were here. This is just an issue they have zero interest in addressing in any fashion whatsoever publicly, except to talk about funding they're doing of research or rule changes that they're trying to make to address the issue. But the league is never, unless forced to, if the commissioner, for example, this Friday, the commissioner will have his sort of state of football address where he, before the Super Bowl, has to answer questions from the media. But we've made endless requests during our reporting on this and, been politely declined throughout. They just have zero interest in actually answering, I think, the challenging questions around.
I actually have friends both at the NFL and at the law firm that represents the NFL, and they didn't even call me back.
Yeah. Welcome to our world.
Yeah, they didn't even call me back.
You have to sue them to get their
attention. I don't even know what to say about
exactly.
That.
One of the interesting things.
Yes.
I worked with Mark and the folks at Frontline and PBS in regards to the League of Denial. And one of the things that we noticed was ESPN was a part of the process. And then when the NFL found out that ESPN was a part of it, apparently there was some pressure applied to ESPN to pull out. And so when ESPN pulled back, I think that aroused everybody's suspicion. And it made League of Denial even more of a must-see event because the NFL, you know, applied this pressure. And I think what the NFL has done with this movie Concussion and events like this is don't say anything and just hope that it just fades away. And I think that's the most important thing that the NFL can do right now. Just try to ignore it, pretend that it doesn't exist, and keep moving forward.
You know, I'm going to talk, I'm going to get back to that in a second because I want to hear whether the NFL pressured you at some point because you ended up getting inducted into the Hall of Fame, and I wonder, and we'll talk about that soon.
Okay.
Mark, I don't know if you remember that, but in League of Denial, you mentioned the 92nd Street Y.
Well, I have it right here.
Oh, look at this.
I was actually going to...
Look, you and me.
Look. If you, you know, I don't want to be like promoting our work, but it's here. If you want to read it, feel free.
I know. I just thought it was an incredible anecdote.
Well, I think it's just so fitting that we're here.
Yes.
So I just, and if you like the writing, my brother wrote it, or I wrote it. If you don't like the writing, my brother wrote it. I screwed up the punchline. Anyway, so this is, it'll be brief. 1994 is sort of what becomes known as the year of the concussion because there's a number of high-profile concussions that happen in the league, to Troy Aikman, Vinny Testaverde, and a number of major players, quarterbacks. And it's there's sort of a groundswell of attention on this, and the media, members of the media, start calling it the year of the concussion. So. We just have a little tidbit that's appropriate tonight. Late in the season of the concussion, Tagliabue, then the commissioner Paul Tagliabue, appeared with two other commissioners, the NBA's David Stern and the NHL's Gary Bettman, in the auditorium at Manhattan's 92nd Street Y to discuss the state of their respective leagues. The panel's moderator was the journalist David Halberstam, who had gone on to a career of writing books, including several about sports, after winning the Pulitzer Prize for his coverage of the Vietnam War for the New York Times. After dispensing with questions about labor relations and league finances, Halberstam turned to the NFL's growing concussion problem. Tagliabue quickly dismissed the matter as a PAC journalism issue, that was his quote, then used the league's dubious statistics to try to deflect concern. Tagliabue repeated the claim that the NFL experienced, quote, one concussion every three or four games, which he said came out to 2.5 concussions for every, quote, 22,000 players engaged. For Halberstam, it was a moment of deja vu. He seemed to be taken back to the days of the 5 o'clock follies, the name the Saigon Press Corps bestowed upon the surreal statistics-crammed U.S. government press briefings. Halberstam compared the NFL commissioner to the former U.S. Defense Secretary. Quote, I feel I'm back in Vietnam hearing McNamara give statistics, he told the audience, which howled. Sports Illustrated, covering the exchange, lit into the commissioner. Tagliabue's head had been spared this season's spate of bruising hits. On this issue, he ought to be making better use of it. Not long after, the NFL announced its own scientific initiative. At Tagliabue's behest, the league said it was assembling a subcommittee of experts to study concussions. Tagliabue's initiative would be called the Mild Traumatic Brain Injury Committee.
And we're going to talk about the irony of that, the Mild Traumatic Brain Injury Committee. Yes, and I love the fact that it said the auditorium howled at the 92nd Street Y. You could have done it again. It would have been the ghosts of an earlier audience. Chris, I do not want to put you in a position to defend the NFL.
That won't happen.
Okay. But you did negotiate with them over a very short period of time. Mm-hmm. In July of 2013, there was an ordered mediation by the court. You'd filed your class action. There was ordered mediation. 2 months later, you and opposing counsel show up back in court with preliminary agreement. There was some back and forth. Back in January, this is only 6 months later, mm-hmm. you have the certification of the class and what looks like the beginnings of a final agreement. It makes one wonder, was the NFL easy to negotiate with? Did you just out-muscle them? Like, what happened? They come to the table so quickly, there's not much discovery that was done. It causes a level of cynicism. Were they afraid that, oh my God, as long as Chris doesn't push the CTE on us, we'll give them anything. We'll just cave instantly. But as long as we don't have to deal with the future diagnoses of CTE, we'll throw $1 billion on the table now. So just take us through that, because it would look to us that as if they quickly thought that there was the legal merits here and there was a reason to settle.
Yeah, so there's a lot to unpack there. So I'm not defending the NFL. I don't need to answer for them. They can do it for themselves. I will say this, that because of the work done by Mark and his brother and others, but mostly them, they really, they exposed something. I mean, this is how I get involved in cases. Usually good journalism, somebody uncovers something, we find out there's something there, we research it, and then go file a case. This was one of those cases, so I thank you for the work you've done here, and I'm sure the players who will benefit from the settlement will as well. But look, at the end of the day, there were some pretty important things going on in the litigation. One was, and I don't know about your timing there, but you know, the case was around for a little over a year, and now it's been probably about 2 years since we've actually announced an attempt to settle, and it's gone through several iterations. One of the big things that was going on in the litigation was that there was a motion to dismiss all of the cases brought by the NFL. Not to make this super complicated, but it was a preemption theory which said that because many of the players, not all, but many of the players were covered by a collective bargaining agreement, the proper place to handle the claims was not in court, but through an arbitration procedure. That motion threatened to dismiss many thousands of cases. You said 5,000 filed. There are actually 22,000 retired players, all of whom are covered in the settlement. So, I can't really give you an answer at what the NFL's motivation was. I can tell you, if you want to talk to me about what the litigation looked like, the risks that were involved, what the science looked like, would it get to a jury, I'm a trial lawyer. I would like to believe that the existential threat was this CTE issue, but it was also the fact that we were willing to try cases against them.
But it wasn't just the mother load.
We had to get to a jury.
The mother load was for them, CTE. Did they sense that they had serious liability on everything else other than CTE?
I wish they were here, but when you say other than, I mean, the case is about CTE. Even the injuries, when you're looking at the compensable injuries in the case, they are all very serious manifestations of very serious diseases like Alzheimer's, ALS, dementia, Parkinson's. They get compensated. But there are other things that are dealt with in it as well, not through compensation, but through testing. You got to realize also, as a plaintiff's lawyer, you know, I'm dealing with a problem that comes in front of me. I have at the time, going back now to 2010, 2011, I had a group of players, probably about two dozen, that were showing problems, and they were way too young to have the kind of problems they were showing. So my first thing as a lawyer is, is there some blame that I can put on the NFL? I went and did the research, read stuff that Mark and his brother did, didn't get to read your book until it came out, but I knew the stuff that was going on. And there was enough there for me then to go out and hire experts and begin to really dig down on the problem. But I had a problem, and that was I needed to get compensation and help to some very sick players.
Well, I want to get to that because that's an important question. Let me start with Arthur here. Arthur, I know you have a lot to say about this particular idea because maybe you can help. There's a lot of laypersons in the audience. Help us understand what a class action accomplishes. You know, on the one hand, individual claims are not being resolved. Awesome. You are forfeiting, in theory, the individual claim for the mass tort. And in doing so, there's the judicial efficiency, right? There's the duplicative cases that no longer have to be handled. There's the risk of loss, risk of going forward with litigation and not prevailing. But in this instance, you could make an argument that people lose their individual ability to tell their own story about what had actually happened to them. So take us through sort of the logic of the mass tort case.
In the good old days, litigation was between two people, a plaintiff and a defendant. You hit my car. No, I didn't. You were driving too fast. One on one. Simple. That all ended with World War II, which some of the people in the audience may remember. Society changed. Phenomena in our society became mass. An airplane crashes, 400 people are killed. A pharmaceutical hits the marketplace, and thousands of people dispersed all around the country, if not the world, develop heart disease or cancers. We only have so many judges, so many courtrooms. We understand that when it's an individual citizen against a big pharmaceutical company, or an individual NFL player against the NFL. You've got a tremendous disparity in economic power and resources. So the system, and this is not new, this has been part of the system, it simply has come to the fore since the 60s, when we began to realize the system couldn't handle 22,000 cases. The system can't handle hundreds of thousands of cases brought by people with asbestosis, people who have cancer from tobacco, people who have taken Vioxx or Actos. So we started to develop procedures, that's what I teach, procedure, that aggregated, try-like things together, pack them, bundle them up. That's where the individuality gets lost. There's no question about that. The individual in a class is trading. I'm trading my right to tell my personal story, to have my literal day in court. But society will give me a figurative day in court. It'll bundle me up with the 22,000 people. Economically, that's good for me. In terms of the efficiency of the system, that's good for me. In terms of the speed of resolution, that's good for me. If I prevail, I'm going to be compensated more quickly. If I have to go it alone, I can't. Now, NFL players, retired or active, are fairly wealthy. But take what I've just said and put it into a situation in which you've just got ordinary Americans, the pill taker, the person who buys a defective television set, the person who is defrauded by phony charges on bills. Can't take on the companies. You can't. And the system can't take them on one by one. And so we pack them.
And we've seen this here in New York. It was very personal to this island, the 9/11 Victims Compensation Fund. Very good example of everyone joining up in part of the Victims Compensation Fund. The Senate created a fund, and there were allocations made out of the fund. Some firemen and bond traders they've opted out and filed their own lawsuits. I don't know whatever happened to them, but we know that there was some certainty. I think there was even a tax-free award
yes.
when it came to the Victims Compensation Fund. It was just done much more quickly and more efficiently.
But you see, society made the judgment to create the fund. The class action has to be done by people like Chris. Other people who sense a problem. Society can't create 9/11 funds every time we are hit by some sort of a disaster, whether it be the mortgage problem of 08, whether it be some of the drugs that unfortunately are in society, whether it's asbestos, whether it's tobacco. We can't do that as a society. We have to rely on people like that.
All right, well, so Chris, relying on you in this instance, I wonder, you're in a tough spot, I think. And maybe you can help us understand it. On the one hand, you have people with great need now, people suffering from Parkinson's disease, ALS. Anyone who knows, I had a cousin that recently died of ALS. I know how fast that goes. Mm-hmm. On the other hand, you have, and for those who've read the book or are familiar with this other core issue is the idea of CTE, which is not really diagnosable until after you die. Here's the dilemma. Yeah. You don't really know you have it until we take an autopsy, a forensic examination of your brain
right.
after you're dead. And so if you're not exhibiting symptoms, there's some people, I think Dr. McKee says in Frontline, everyone has CTE or she believes that they do. The settlement is not including CTE. It's excluding CTE. The NFL will be protected by CTE unless a player dies before the settlement and his brain is autopsied and it finds out CTE. So the question here for you as a lawyer, and I think it's a tough ethical question, is you're representing a class. Some of the people in the class are not really being represented if they're really suffering from CTE. We don't know. On the other hand, you have real people who are calling you up and saying, Chris, I need some money now. I need some help right now. I mean, is there an ethical dilemma here? And I, Arthur, maybe you might want to jump in here too to see. Here, there's a different ethical standard that applies to the class action attorney?
So let me take the first crack at this. The answer is no, and here's the reason why. You answered it yourself. Because you can't diagnose CTE in living people. So all you can look at are symptoms, the manifestation of symptoms. So we did a few things in the settlement. One is, for people who exhibit certain symptoms, those that indicate ALS, Alzheimer's, Parkinson's, and dementia, you get compensated, and significantly, seven figures if you're younger, less if you're older. All, you don't have to prove causation in the settlement, which you would have to in a court case. And again, I mentioned earlier with just a point that's important for the audience to understand, because in understanding the widespread acceptance of the case, it's an important point. 22,000 retired players and 170 have opted themselves out. Arthur will tell you that in class actions, those kinds of numbers are unheard of. Now, one other thing. It's a very cohesive group of players.
So this is 1%?
It's less than 1%. Harry will tell you that this is a very cohesive group of players. So when we were dealing with communications, these players speak to each other. They belong to alumni associations. They're in chat rooms. When the settlement was going, some players who didn't like the settlement, who were objecting or opting out, created websites that put information up that I would say is not totally accurate. They were guided by lawyers. So I'm answering your question in a very long way, because you have to begin to, it's a very complicated case, and when you try to simplify it by saying it compensates CTE or it doesn't, you're missing the point. CTE cannot be diagnosed. Kevin Turner is my class rep. He has ALS. He probably, because of these appeals, will not see the money that his kids will get before he dies. He's not the only one. Steve Smith. There are many. I can name a number. Tim Shaw is a young player who recently has been diagnosed with ALS. So the first concern is, I got to get compensation to the guys who cannot work, whose wives are caring for them, and can't support their families. Now, I did that. We did that in the settlement. The second part we did is, we have a fund that's going to be around for 65 years. So players today that are not exhibiting symptoms, but who may have this pathological finding of CTE, and we can't tell because they're alive, and maybe one day there'll be a diagnosis in the living, but again, I have to deal with a lawsuit today. If they get sick with one of those diagnosable injuries 10 years from now, 20 years from now, 30 years from now, 40 years from now, they get compensated at an inflation-adjusted rate. So inflation takes care of that. So I would have to push back against the premise that we're not compensating. You said CTE. What we are compensating are diseases that are associated with CTE. But CTE is a pathological finding. And the last point I'll make is that, and this is mentioned in Judge Brody's opinion. She wrote a 132-page opinion dealing with objections, specifically that objection, and spent several pages discussing it. Again, it's a legal case. When you end a legal case, you don't end the discussion. Mark is still talking about concussions. Harry's still talking about concussions. I needed to take care of a case, and I had to deal with the science that was there today. So the question is, would this judge have allowed the existing science to go to a jury? And some of the biggest, you mentioned one name, and then there are other names, the leading scientists in this field who have published peer-reviewed medical literature, conclude most of their studies by saying further research is needed. We don't know enough. We don't know how to clinically diagnose this problem. That doesn't go to a jury. That case gets dismissed. So I'm just trying to say it's a very complicated
case. And in that instance, speaking of the point that Arthur made, that case would disappear. And by simply being a member of the class,
thousands would disappear.
They now participate in a recovery that they might have been on the end of a dismissal.
And they don't have to prove causation. They just prove they're an NFL player, a diagnosis of an injury, mm-hmm. and you get compensated.
Arthur?
A lawsuit deals with what you know when you bring it and try it. You can't wait around to solve the CTE mystery. It may come next week. It may not come for 10 to 20 years. In the meantime, as Chris points out, people are dying. When the Vietnam vets brought a class action because they were rained on by Agent Orange, the assumption was that the chemicals in Agent Orange caused autoimmune diseases. But the science wasn't there. They had to settle, much the way Chris has settled with the NFL, because as of those moments in time, you could only deal with what you know. If you don't know it, you can't prove it. In a perfect world, you could prove it. There's an old cliche thing. The quest for perfection is the enemy of the good. You can only do the best job you can as of today.
Now, the attorney who represents, there is an appeal before the Third Circuit. I don't know when that decision is going to, whether it's imminent. I know you're waiting on it. In the meantime, the point that you made is you have clients that can't get paid. Well,
it's all on hold.
While it's on
NFL
hold.
NFL is sitting on their money.
The
right
attorney
now.
Who represented, represents that those group of lawyer players wasn't able to make it today. He's in D.C. and he got ill and he wasn't. It's a shame. Would have been interesting to hear what he had to say. But yes, that there is an appeal, and the appeal is based specifically on this, the very point that Chris and Arthur just talked about. CTE was not covered under the settlement, for perhaps for the very reasons that you both said. And the question is, for people who may eventually die of CTE, in theory, they're being unrepresented because they may in fact die of that disease, but again, more research is required. I want to read something from what Harry wrote. This is from Harry's Pro Football Hall of Fame acceptance speech. And you said the following. As a Hall of Famer, I want to implore the NFL and its union to look at the product that you have up on this stage. And then you said, I would hope that the leaders of the NFL, the future commissioner, and the Players Association do a much better job of looking out for those individuals, meaning the players. You gotta look out for them. If we made the league what it is, you have to take better care of your own. It's very well said. I know that Mike Webster's death affected you deeply. I know you played against him. I also know I read somewhere that at first you were not even a part of the class, that you were somewhat ambivalent about being part of the class. I don't know if you remember that, but let's just talk about, you know, that it was a moving moment, very rare for a Hall of Famer to make a speech pleading with the league on behalf of his fellow players about taking care of their own.
It took me a long time to get into the Pro Football Hall of Fame. And so one of the things that I noticed was each year they would introduce the Hall of Famers and they'd come out and be on stage and they'd walk out and they'd wave and be saluted. Then they'd walk out a little slower the next year, and then a little slower the next year.
You're saying every year players come back and sit on stage?
Yeah, and so then, you know, I saw former players, Hall of Famers, walking out with canes, and then you would see that these guys were being introduced and they're already seated, and then they were gone. And so one of the chief complaints back then was that so many players were having a very difficult time qualifying for disability. And the disabilities that we're talking about are, you know, knee, back, whatever. And then there were a small group of former players talking about, you know, neurological issues. I myself was diagnosed in 1990 with post-concussion syndrome. So I sort of knew
what is that? What is that? Is that?
Well, when I played, I knew that there was something going on. And, you know, I was trained to be in touch with myself physically. You know, if I hurt my knee, I knew, you know, my knee was hurt, my ankle was whatever. But I knew there was something going on. I couldn't really put my finger on exactly what it was, where I was depressed for no apparent reason. I was having migraine headaches occasionally. I would have days where I would be on and everything is, you know, I'm sharp and crisp and everything. And then there were other days where I was just dragging. You know, I couldn't really understand what was going on. And so I was also captain of the Giants, and I'd be doing interviews after the game, and I would be searching to find the words that I wanted to use to finish my thought. And, you know, I just lost the ability to communicate effectively at times. And I kept it to myself. And it wasn't until I retired in 1988, made a transition to television, and there were things like I would lose my train of thought live on the air. And I went to see my doctor for my yearly physical in 1990, and I passed, and he said, you know, is there anything else going on? I said, no, everything's fine. He said, are you sure? And I said, well, you know, I've been having problems with involuntary muscle twitches and migraines and headaches, you know, flash photography like this guy here is, you know, taking pictures and...
This is bothering you.
Yeah. No, it's not bothering me now, but, you know, I just sort of...
Guy.
Yeah, I just sort of went down this whole list of things that I was having problems with. And he referred me to a specialist. I went through 2 days of testing, and the result came back as a mild post-concussion syndrome. It was deemed to be permanent in nature because it had been 2 years since I'd hit anyone or gotten hit. And so it was a relief for me to hear because I thought I had a brain tumor. and so when I learned that I needed to manage the condition, yeah, I just sort of went on with my life and I started to pull up information on post-concussion syndrome. But it dawned on me that if I was dealing with this issue, there are probably a lot of other players dealing with the same thing. And so I became very vocal and outspoken about it, and I went public and I talked about it. And with
did it affect the Hall of Fame?
It did not affect the Hall of Fame.
Did the NFL ever call you and say, what are you doing?
No, the NFL has never called me, but more recently, you know, I've been talking about this issue for 25 years. And, you know, people thought I was crazy just talking about it. And I feel validated now with League of Denial and concussion and, you know, that what I was dealing with, you know, I never thought that it would gain as much traction as it has. And the number of players who didn't know what a concussion was years ago, now everybody knows what a concussion is. And parents are taking steps in, you know, determining whether their kids are going to play football now or not. And so it had nothing to do with getting into the Pro Football Hall of Fame. But, you know, I just knew that there were a lot of former players dealing with not only physical issues, but neurological issues. Mm-hmm. And nobody was doing anything about it. And some of these guys went so far as to commit suicide, whether it was Terry Long drinking antifreeze or Justin Strelzik driving his car down the upcoming lane, or whether it was Mike Webster, who I was trained to hit him right in the face with my elbow with all of my power to get to the ball carrier. And so when he started exhibiting all of this erratic behavior, I knew that there was something going on, and it wasn't just something that he was making up. But people from the Players Association and the league were in denial, and these guys were suffering unnecessarily.
Well, you know, I don't want to bring up a bad memory, Harry, but I think in the book, I'm not mistaken, you say yourself that there was one time you were driving over the Tappan Zee Bridge,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you had that moment thought about, you knew there was a section, a curve, mm-hmm. that people jumped off, and you said, you know, what if I just drove my car off? And
well, that was during that era when I was dealing with depression, but that was during my career.
Right.
And it was like 1981. And my daughter was young, and I vividly remember, you know, my thought was, if I did something to myself, who would take care of my daughter? Mm-hmm. And so that was really the reason why I opted not to do anything, because you know, there were people who were driving on the bridge, jumping off the bridge. And, you know, it was a thought that I had, and I was thinking, why am I having these thoughts?
Yeah.
And so I could very well relate to former players who have committed suicide and what they were probably going through.
Mark, we have such a moral dilemma when we deal with this issue. You point out so well in the book that this case screams of big tobacco. It looks like big tobacco, and maybe we can talk a little about what's familiar with big tobacco, except for one point you make, which is we love football. You know, it's a very different experience. Some people, I think the joke you made, only in Texas are people addicted to football. But so it's not quite the addiction of tobacco. But it is our national pastime. If we're cheering for football, now that we know what the statistics are, we're cheering for an accident. You know, we're cheering for people. It's as if we're cheering on a freeway. Please get in an accident. We don't hear people saying, well, maybe it should just be touch football, right? Saying, you know, this is ridiculous. Why should Harry Carson go through this? I mean, what would Americans think? This is a very different, tell us a little about, just in terms of your own investigative reporting, in terms of who you were talking to. One of the great anecdotes in the book is that even the doctors that have been the pioneers of learning about the relationship between concussions and brain disease, all of them are huge football fans. Packer fans, Steeler fans, they've got like bobbleheads in their labs. And yet they're doing this research that is dooming the NFL. They know the truth, but they love the game. It must have been an interesting, very different from covering tobacco. Or for instance, you covered the Balco steroids scandal. This is different in so many ways.
Yeah, it's really interesting. I mean, people ask us all the time, like, do we still love football and do we watch it? And I fully admit I'm a huge football fan. And Steve and I get together on weekends and still watch. And, you know,
your brother,
my
right?
brother,
who co-wrote the book.
Yeah. And you know, he used to have 49ers season tickets, although they're so impossible to watch now and they're awful that it's you know. But I think it's very true. I mean, you know, if you look, Anne McKee, the woman who's on there, that she's the foremost authority on this research at this point. She studied more brains of former NFL players than anybody, and she's a massive cheesehead. She grew up Packer fan. She grew up in Appleton, Wisconsin, where the Packers train. She has in her office a cheese head, which is like one of those, put on this big hat and it looks like a piece of cheese. And she's got a bobbleheads of Packers and she's just a giant Packers fan, but totally tormented in the same way by what she's seeing when she looks at brains of players. And, you know, I think there's no doubt I think talking to a lot of former players and their families was incredibly striking because, you know, Harry and I were talking before this started. Steve and I did a piece for ESPN recently about a kid named Chris Borland. Mm-hmm. And Borland, if you don't know who he is, was a rookie for the 49ers 2 years ago. He was 24 years old. He had a nearly rookie of the year season. Just a phenomenal player. He'd gone to the University of Wisconsin, where Mike Webster had gone to play. And Borland decided very early on during his rookie season that he was going to retire after 1 year, that he was not going to play. And he made that decision. He had no concussion issues. He had no brain issues no neurocognitive problems. But he just started to research the problem. He started to talk to some of these scientists. He read our book. And he just started to really sort of embrace an understanding of what had happened. And he retired. He gave up hundreds of thousands of dollars in a very promising career. And when you talk to Chris about this, there's an element of him being tormented because he just loves the sport. He loved to play the sport. And I think, you know, one of the things we all love about it, and Chris would talk about, is the violence of it. We all love the fact that guys are hitting each other as hard as they can. These are unbelievable athletes. And, you know, Steve makes I think one of the problems and one of the reasons why the sport is as popular is it's not a problem. I mean, I love it. But one of the things that is really difficult is as good as HDTV has gotten, I don't think people have any idea what football is like, and Harry can speak to this more than anybody. But when you watch the game as a sports writer, you go down to the sidelines at the end of the game before you go into the locker room to interview players, and so you see the last 3 minutes of the game on the sideline, and it's an entirely different sport. The game is so fast, it's so loud, it's so violent. You just can't believe guys get up. And Steve has made the analogy, my brother, that I think is a really good one, which is, imagine the difference between looking at a freeway and just watching the cars go by from afar, from above, just watching the cars sort of fly by, looking down on them, versus standing in the median and watching cars go by you at 65 or 70 miles an hour. It's just a dramatically different experience. And in the same way that, like, the war is a muted experience for us, and we don't really get a sense of what that's like for soldiers, I think the same is very much true around football.
You know, we didn't want to take the extra time to show a graphic that I had, so Rick, don't show it, but I had a graphic to show how many concussions are reported every year in the NFL, and in fact, over this past year alone, there was a 58% increase in the number of concussions that players had just in this year alone.
And of course, can I just say, the funny thing about that is, so the NFL previously had a drop in concussions, which they attributed to their own success at addressing the problem. And then now they've had a spike in concussions, which they also address to their own success in addressing the problem, because now they're paying more attention to it.
Right.
So They sort of want it both ways.
One of the things that I thought the graphic, which I'm not showing you, indicated that wide receivers and defensive backs are particularly vulnerable. They're the ones that have the largest numbers of concussions to those, I guess, players on the outside of the field. Here's a question, really, I think that maybe Arthur, Chris, and Harry can maybe answer together, because you've all touched on it in certain ways. If the cases had gone individually and not a tort, a mass tort, mass class action, the player would be exposed to all kinds of affirmative defenses, including contributory negligence, comparative fault. What about the concept, and I guess, Harry, can you ever really blame a player, someone who has, an especially aggressive playing style, right? Someone who has poor tackling technique. Like, I don't know if this is ridiculous to you, but one could imagine that these would be the legal issues. Chris, you could probably told your clients, you're going to avoid that. You're going to avoid having to defend against seeing film of you playing and saying, you're a nutcase out there, and you're the reason this is the cause. It's interesting. I actually remembered a little anecdotally from my, high school, college years. Tony Dorsett was known for trying to not get hit. He was always trying to run out of bounds. You played with him, so he was fast and he run out of bounds. Walter Payton was known for just taking it to the defenders, right? Tony Dorsett is in this class, and is one of the main plaintiffs, right? Has exhibited troubles. Obviously, running out of bounds didn't make that much of a difference. He still got hit enough. Is there a way for players to actually be negligent on the field? Is that a question that we can even ask in this instance? Or secondly, is there a way to make it safer for them out on the field? And I don't know whether Arthur and Chris explored this question as well.
Well, I mean, I can tell you very quickly, because I think what Harry has to say is more interesting, because I think it's a good question. I'd like to hear Harry's answer, but from a legal perspective, it is an issue. I mean, it's not just an issue because of the NFL. You got to remember, these players played in Pop Warner, high school, college, and most likely were stars for the most part. Maybe some of them were late bloomers.
So are you saying the causation question can start in high school?
Mark knows this. If anybody's looked at the science, there's very substantial science that indicates damaging young brains is what can cause a really big problem. So we got a causation issue. But this isn't a secret of the trade, but anybody who tries cases does focus groups. And I will tell you, and I did them because, I didn't know what was gonna happen in preemption. As people may remember, before the case settled and they put up $1 billion, people said we weren't gonna get a nickel because the NFL had never settled a case before. So we prepared for a long-term war and trying cases, whatever was left.
And I think it's important for some people who don't know, and you should just remind people, that there were cases that were brought against the NFL, including Mike Webster's family, which is really sort of the great tragedy here, that it are the key stories in the Legal Denial book and in the film, and they lost. At no point did the NFL win.
Well, Webster won.
And the Players Association sided with the NFL.
You used the analogy to tobacco before.
Yeah.
For 50 years, no individual beat the tobacco industry. Jury after jury after jury basically were saying, you knew, you breathe in smoke, assumption of the risk, the lawyers call it. Harry knew from Pop Warner on, it's a violent game.
But he thought it was his knee. He didn't know it was
that's an interesting trial question. Causation is an interesting trial question.
So that's where I was going, on the focus groups.
Yeah.
So I'll say we did a lot, and they were going to be challenging. I'm walking a tightrope here, right? Because I'm still counsel in the case. I'll just say,
what you mean by a focus group?
A focus group is we make presentations and we do really, it's a streamlined thing. We do it in a day, maybe two, but where we actually mock try the case, and we bring in 30 people. And we at the end, they deliberate. Sometimes they know it's a fake case, and we're just testing it. Sometimes they think they're really helping you settle the case. And I will just say this, without getting into where they came out, there were some really challenging trial issues. Assumption of risk was a big one. they think every retired NFL player is a millionaire, has the money, and why are you complaining? You just want more, which I will tell you, and Harry, again, probably is the better one to speak to it than me, but I've spent now years with NFL players. They're not millionaires. Many of them are. I mean, I'm not saying there aren't a few that invested their money well, but they were young kids making a lot of money. You know, you're making a couple million dollars a year, you buy a house, and you act like you're somebody who's going to make a couple million a year for 40 years, and you're really only making it for 4 or 5 years.
But that makes them unsympathetic.
It makes them unsympathetic, and you get this very strange pushback. And I'll tell you one other thing. Any of you, go and look at some of the articles that Mark, his brother, and other journalists published about this. Go down to the comments section. The hardcore fans are like calling the player, I mean, these are guys that never took a hit in their life, calling NFL players crybabies. And so all I'm saying is, I'm not saying they're not winnable. They are winnable. I'm just saying there are a lot of challenging issues that you deal with dealing with this population of plaintiffs.
Harry, what about the idea of contributory negligence? Do you think that this is even a morally permissible thing to question? Maybe we can say it about smokers, but for the love of God, if you're out there tackling someone, you can't blame them for tackling them aggressively.
Well, one of the things that I've always said is before I stepped on the football field, I knew that you can get hurt physically. And I assumed that risk, and I went out for the team, and I played. And yeah, I got hurt. From a neurological standpoint, nobody told me that you can hurt your brain.
Is that because of the helmet?
It's because of the helmet, but you don't think about that. You think about the physical risks of playing the game. The knee, the ankle, the shoulders, whatever, back, whatever. Even, you know, in terms of, you know, hurting your spine, you know what the risk is. But from that neurological standpoint, nobody has... No one says anything, no coach, nobody mentions anything about hurting your brain and that having some adverse effect down the road. We've talked about the NFL. The reality is this problem is not just an NFL problem. Yeah. It's a football problem. And my wife is sitting here, and she can tell you, I get mail and correspondence from people who never played in the NFL, but they're now dealing with the issues of concussions, having played high school ball, mm-hmm. a low college ball, and now they're in their 40s, and they're dealing with these issues. What the NFL has encountered is an issue that is going to be more widespread. We're only talking about the tip of the iceberg when it comes to the issues of traumatic brain injury in people who have played football. And so I sort of sit in this very unique position where I see those guys ahead of me who have passed away, whether it be Frank Gifford or any other individual who, you know, passes away and has CTE. But I also see many of those guys, Tony Dorsett, those guys who I played with, who are now dealing with the issues of traumatic brain injury, and the younger guys who are coming out now who are also dealing with this issue. So, you know, I have this seat where I can see all of these people, and I know what's coming for a lot of these guys coming down the pike.
Mark, what's the future of football in a situation like this? We know statistically that the numbers in Pop Warner are down. We also know that the science has convinced parents to say, I forgot what the number, don't let your kid play until high school, right? Stay out of the junior leagues altogether. The commissioner here must have a real problem on his hand, which is he's got a product that everybody wants, but is he going to be able to field teams? Now, this is a league, as you know, that spent, you know, decades, you know, as the title of the book, denying the link between head trauma and concussions and brain disease, and debunking the science, which can't be done anymore because now the science is motoring along, and we're going to know more
and
more.
Don't tell the NFL that. They're still trying.
Yeah, they're still trying to debunk the science. But, you know, in 5 years, right, it may be that they'll be actually able to, the thing that Arthur said earlier might not be a problem. They might actually be able to diagnose CTE while the player's alive. That could happen in 5 years.
What's going to happen? Come on.
Tell us have all the answers.
Have we passed the golden era of football? We should soak in every game we can get.
I mean, I think if a commissioner of the NFL ends up sort of at a crossroads around this, it's definitely not going to be this commissioner. It's going to be a commissioner 20, 30, 40, 50 years from now. Because again, I mean, there's a few issues. That's not to say that they're not facing significant issues right now, because if you don't think they're worried about it, all you have to do is look at the way they're marketing the sport. They have completely shifted from marketing entirely around the violence of the sport to now marketing around safety and suggesting, you know, their mantra now is the sport is safer than it's ever been. And they're promoting a program at the youth level called Heads Up Football, which is supposedly this idea that there's a way to actually take the head out of the game. And if you talk to anybody like Harry or anybody who's played the sport, they tell you that's crazy. But they're spending millions of dollars marketing that sort of tool. At the same time, I think it really is going to be the science that dictates, you know, where we are. If it's going to take a significant longitudinal study that looks at players from now exactly. to 20, 30, 40 years from now to determine what is the actual prevalence of CTE amongst football players. Okay. Anne McKee is thinking it's going to be virtually everybody. She's looked at 91 brains now. She's seen 87 of them with CTE.
McKee was one of the women in the video, right?
So if, as she says, you know, 30 or 40 years from now, we see that the number is, I don't know, 30%, are we then going to sort of have some sort of moral dilemma about what we do and how we look at the sport? But I don't think you're going to get there till then. But I do think, and as Harry talked about, the issue is much more a question at the youth level. And that issue is changing dramatically. And there are, you know, we did that story about 2 years ago, 10% fewer players playing Pop Warner football. And that's just Pop Warner, not Babe Ruth football. And there's a bunch of other leagues. So I think that question is much more telling, and certainly that will trickle up to the league, but there's not going to be a shortage of players who are, you know, I think one of the theories that people have espoused is that what you're going to see is a sort of changing demographic, and that there'll be a class shift in the sport, and I that's a hypothesis that seems reasonable, but I you know, I don't think we have any idea.
That's the way I see it. The game of football is not going to be affected. I mean, especially on the NFL level, everybody still loves football. And when you have the dollars that are being paid out, you know, you have kids who are going to say, I want to be a football player. You know, if I hurt my brain, then I'll deal with it when that time comes. But I'm in a very impoverished situation right now. I'm going to make the money for my family. You see it every year where Radio City, these players are introduced, first round picks. They come out, give a little hug to the commissioner, put on the cap. Mother is behind backstage. God, thank you for blessing my son for being in this situation, not understanding what they're sending their kids out there to do in terms of damaging their brain. But they assume the risks for the millions of dollars that are being paid. You know, when you talk about in the past, the most I ever made as a football player was $550,000, I'm being completely honest with you. So that's not something that is going to last for the rest of your life. But with the dollars that players are being paid now, you know, they're going to do everything that they can do to hang on to that job if they're in the league now. But you look at all of these young guys, especially down in the SEC, you know, that's their out when they're coming from, you know, one-parent homes, and you know they're trying to stay out of trouble, and they're trying to buy that house and buy that bling and buy that car and everything. They're looking at that. They're not looking at what might happen to them down the road.
If one quick thought, yeah. Thane. I mean, it's similar to boxing. Boxing over the years has become a poor man's sport because it's a way to, you know, get yourself out of a bad situation. And unfortunately, that's the way I see football going. Because if you have access to other sports where you don't have to get hit in the head and you're a good athlete, you can go play those. But if football is the thing or boxing is the way you're going to get out of the situation, you're going to avail you and you're not going to worry about the consequences until it's too late.
Chris, don't I know this about you? You were a boxer.
Yeah. Well, I played a lot of rough sports. And, you know, my kid, my 7-year-old, I had him wrestling last year. You know, 2 months into the season, he suffered a concussion. That was it. Wrestling's done. Rough sports are done. But I made a decision that every parent has to make. I don't want my kids doing rough sports.
Well, I made a decision that a pop, a grandfather makes, and that is my grandson is 6, does swimming, golf, but he's not doing football.
Absolutely. Soccer.
Yeah.
And they don't let little kids, but by the way, because of this concussion stuff, and look, I don't mean to say this too much, I don't want to embarrass him, but the kind of this kind of journalism that exposes this kind of problem and the lawsuits, which come after your journalism, make big differences. In soccer, for example, kids are not allowed to head the ball. If they put their head on the ball, it's like touching it with the hand. It's a penalty. And things are changing, and they're trying to protect those young brains now. And it's all a result of the I got hit a few times too many. It's all a result of the exposure because of this issue.
You know, you talk about the League of Denial. That really was a godsend.
Can we stop?
No. Really? No. No, seriously.
I put you in the
it's
middle.
Harry rub his other shoulder.
Jesus. It was really.
Now I feel compelled to challenge Chris about the lawsuit. After.
It was really a godsend for an individual
I'll pull a
like
Trump
me
on you.
Because I would do an interview, and I would tape it, and if you know the television station or if they perceive that I'm attacking the NFL in some way, that's always cut out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it's always just a little clip. And League of Denial was probably one of the first features that spoke with the doctors in depth, players, and it provided information for people to sit and just watch and absorb. And there's so many people who have written me and they've said, I watched League of Denial, I look at the game completely different. They haven't seen concussion yet, but what PBS and Frontline did, and what you guys did, is you gave everybody an opportunity to see exactly what happened with guys like Mike Webster and the issues of concussions, but also the NFL and what their attitude was regarding this condition.
Harry,
it's only 20.
He's offering. He's offering.
I'll take it.
That's all you got.
So we know Pop said the grandkids are going to be swimmers, but if Harry Carson, young Pop Warner Harry Carson, had been given a helmet and said, you know, it's not just your knee and shoulders, but it's going to be your head. And you know, Harry, we've seen you for years. You're so beloved in this city, in particular.
Thank you.
We really adore you for your years with the Giants. But you are such a thoughtful, articulate person. You know, I don't know what you were like as a kid, but could you have said
thoughtful?
There you go. Would you have said, you know what? This is not for me. I want a life, and even though I might have a Hall of Fame career, I'm going to turn away from it.
You don't think about Hall of Fame. When I was in the seventh grade, I went to a game. I saw the players walking off the field, and that's where all the girls were. They were hanging out with the guys up by the locker room.
It's always that.
And I thought to myself, I want to do that. And I went off of football in the ninth grade, not prepared or anything, and I quit on that first day of practice. I quit. And I didn't like the taste of quitting in my gut, and so I went back the next year, and I was determined to stick and stay. And I went back, I hung in there, and I made it. The difference between me and most other players love football. I mean, they breathe football, and they eat football, and all of that stuff. For me, I was just challenging myself to make it through. I quit my team. With like two or three games left in my senior year, I wound up getting a scholarship to South Carolina State, sort of as a walk-on, and I played 4 years at South Carolina State, and then I was drafted to play with the Giants. But when I graduated from South Carolina State, I had a degree. And so that was the freedom that I had, and I had a degree in education. Mm-hmm. And so that's the difference between me and so many others. I played football because it was something to do, not. Yeah, I knew it was going to be over at some point, but I've always tried to think as an educator, and because that's what I was trained to do. And so with this whole situation, I feel like a teacher trying to share information with people who need to know this information. Now, whatever you want to do in regards to this information, you go ahead and do it. But as long as parents have a full understanding of what they're signing their kids up for, if they want to do that, then God bless them.
We're going to take a few questions from the audience, but first I have one question I really need to ask Chris. Chris, is $1 billion going to do it? Is that number going to hold up over a number of years? I know that there's a provision in the settlement that says 10 years into it, the parties are going to sit down again.
It was changed. It's now an uncapped deal. So the $1 billion is an estimate. could be more. I mean, keep in mind that even if the case, once it's affirmed in the Third Circuit and we begin to finally implement the case, there is still litigation going on in the settlement. There are issues, like for example, I don't want to use names, but there are players that may have a, you know, who may have died and have a statute of limitations issue. We have teed those issues up for this judge to rehear them at a later date so that certain people aren't excluded, certain important people aren't excluded. There are, and by the way, the settlement itself does not take into, I mean, any year you played, even if you're 75 years old, you get a diagnosis, you get compensated. So, but it's uncapped, meaning it could be $2 billion, it could be $5 billion. We don't know. The actuarial reports estimate 3 out of 10 players will come down with a serious diagnosed injury that we define in the settlement. If that number moves by 1 to 4, then the value of the deal goes up, you know, it's exponentially.
Arthur, so. When you do things in the aggregate, when you bundle, we're all not peas in a pod. The 22,000 players are individuals. You worried about their individuality when we started the discussion. These issues that are sort of below the radar, because it's not the big issue as to the approval of the settlement. These issues, this settlement, assuming it's approved, will probably be administered much longer than any of us are alive.
Me too.
It has a life of its own. It goes on. It's when those individuals can say, hey, I've got this problem or this problem. We're transforming our civil justice system to try and deal with these mass phenomena and mass litigations. We're into it only for 10 or 20 years. It represents, I think, the biggest challenge to our civil justice system I've seen in my professional life. And judges of goodwill, like Judge Brody in Philadelphia, they are struggling, trying, building new mousetraps all the time. And creative lawyers have to present these.
Yes, of course.
In regards to the settlement, the way I sort of look at it is, you know, I don't want that money, because if you're getting that money, it means that you have been diagnosed with Lou Gehrig's disease, dementia, Alzheimer's,
Parkinson's.
I don't want the money. I want to have a good quality of life. I want to make sure that I live for as long as I can live and have a good quality of life and not necessarily have to dip into that money. And obviously there are some who need it, but you know, I just thank God that I'm not at that point where you know, I'm going to be sending in my name for you know, part of that settlement.
Here's a couple questions from the audience. I know all of you might have some knowledge about this. Here's the first one. I've heard stories of, quote, bowls of painkillers, close quote, made available to players before games. Is it still true? I mean, has the culture changed around the league? I know we have concussion protocols. This is a term of art that I just heard for the first time, right? You hear about it all the time. Players now taken off the field, they used to send them right back, and now they have to go through these protocols. I don't know whether we think, well, that's part of the new culture of the league, and that giving people bowls of painkillers is not something we're going to allow to do anymore. Do we know anything about this?
There was a case, actually, a class action that was filed on behalf of players who were alleging that they had become addicted to painkillers because they were readily available in the locker room. Unfortunately, that case was dismissed under by the preemption ruling that a judge issued in that case. But yeah, I can't speak to the details of it. I can tell you that my clients, the players I've spoken to, and some of them are older. I don't know what it's like today, frankly, but the painkillers were readily available in all forms.
His question, football has certainly passed baseball as, quote, our national pastime. Okay. It's taken as a truth here. Does the panel believe that football has finally peaked? And this person is saying that I don't believe that it's in decline, but is wondering whether that it's seen its best days. Mark,
it's,
maybe.
It's so hard to imagine, isn't it? I mean, I know people said that about boxing, too, because it was so popular in the 50s. But I was laughing. I was reading. I'm from the Bay Area, and so I was reading the San Francisco Chronicle today here in New York, and I was looking at the stories, you know, the Super Bowl's in the Bay Area now, and they had, yesterday was Media Day, and Media Day used to be like a Tuesday at the stadium where, like, you know, 100 media would show up or whatever, and they would cover the event, and the NFL, in only the way the NFL can, it's become a total event now. And so the Media Day was a primetime televised event by the NFL, including inviting fans, well, not inviting, they let fans attend for the price of $30 for a ticket, and they basically, fans sat in the stands and watched the players be interviewed.
You can't even hear what they're saying.
Well, you actually know they had, I read this, they had like, you could have a you know, they'd give you earphones, and you could dial into various stages where the players were, so you could hear what the players were being asked. And sometimes, of course, they're crazy stuff. I was reading, you know, it's turned into a total spectacle. There was like an Austrian journalist walking around with a pair of skis to sort of like point out that he's from Austria, I guess. I don't, you know. But it's a, you know, I think the commissioner at one point, it's a $10 billion industry right now. And I think the commissioner, I feel like I remember reading or hearing that the commissioner had stated the goal is to make it a $25 billion industry within the next 10 years. So, I mean, there's no sign. The numbers are obscene. The ratings are, you know, at this point, it's hard to imagine that it's really peaked.
They did that with draft day.
Right.
That's like watching grass grow.
Yeah. It's four
drafting
days.
One after another. And by the way, I'm a baseball fan. I am a deep believer that, at least in my head, that's still the national pastime. And since Rob Manfred, the new commissioner, was my student at Harvard, he's going to bring it back to the top.
You heard Arthur Miller predicting that baseball will come back again as the national pastime. Our evening is coming to has come to an end. Before we say goodnight to our friends, two quick announcements. One is, if you're receiving CLE credit for tonight, please sign out on your way out. Otherwise, you can't get your certificate. The forum on law, culture, and society will be here again tomorrow night as well for a conversation with Lawrence Summers. Very different, a different off-speed pitch than what we've had tonight. But this was an incredibly engaging, enormously interesting, and entertaining night. I want to thank Arthur Miller, Chris Seeger, Mark Fainaru-Wada, and of course, Harry Carson. Good night, everyone. Thank you.